students, a very warm welcome to a 1 hour session on design of machine elements. I am Deepak from Mechanical Department, assistant professor, who currently taught this particular subject in this semester. Okay, so I am going to give an overview on concepts that are equally important for GATE as well as your end semester exam. Okay, and I will teach you according to your course outcomes also. Okay, so we will be going in depth into the subject right now. So when I say design, okay, design is interpreted as wrongly when it comes to other fields. Design is different in mechanical engineering. I can term it as mechanical engineering design. Now, what is difference between a design and a mechanical engineering design? Because as a design engineer, when you want to design a mechanical element or a machine element, you should first know the what are the types of loads acting on it, or else the application, area of application. Because area of application gives you the clear idea regarding the forces that are acting on a particular machine component. Then you can go through the, when you know the forces, then you can get an idea what are the stresses that are acted upon due to these forces. By knowing the stresses, you can find the strength of a material. From finding the strength of the material, from this finding strength of the particular machine element, you can choose a material from the manufacturer's catalog and you can design the geometric properties. So these are the steps that are to be followed by a design engineer. Believe me, these is not a single step method. It is an iterative process where you have to do it for number of simulations. Okay, as of now, as I said that as a design engineer, you should be more clarity, you should have more clarity regarding the area of application. When you know the area of application, you know the type of loads or forces acting on that particular machine component. So in this regard, I want to give a clear concept regarding the types of forces we will be going through in this particular DME course. So the first force is axial force. The first force is axial force. The stress that is developed due to this axial force, we call it as axial stress. Okay, axial stress. This axial force is sometimes termed as longitudinal force also. So even though if it termed as longitudinal force, it produces axial stress. Now the second is transverse slash bending force. So it gives rise to bending stress. Okay, now the third one is shear force, okay, slash torsion, which gives rise to shear stress, okay. Now when I say bending, what is the formula for bending stress? Unless we will be going for the axial. Now what is the formula for axial stress? Sigma A is equal to P by A. Let us consider P as an axial load and A will be the area resisting the load. Okay? So the resistance can be termed as, you know, the axial stress, which is sigma A is equal to P by A. Now when it comes to transverse or bending force, bending stress will be developed, and this bending stress can be taken from Euler's or its Bernoulli's loading equation, that is E by R is equal to M by I is equal to sigma B by Y. So from which I can say sigma B is equal to MY by, sigma B is equal to MY by I. So when you are going for a circular cross section, so we will be, you know, learning the terms in this particular formula before going into the cross sections. So M is bending moment, okay. Y is distance from neutral axis to outermost fiber, and I is inertia. Now you will be finding, you know, one by one these particular components, and you will be getting to know the formula. You will be getting to find the stress in due to transverse loading, that is bending stress. Okay. Now when we go for shear, or else the stress that is developed due to torsional, due to torsion, it will be T by J is equal to tau by R is equal to G theta by L. It can be regarded as tau is equal to TR by J. Tau is equal to TR by J, where T is torque that is acting on a particular machine element. R is nothing but, you know, the radius of a particular machine element, which is circular in cross section, and J is polar moment of inertia, which will be acting perpendicularly, inertia IZZ. Okay, IZZ is equal to IXX plus IYY, which will be Z is equal to pi d power 4 by 32, and I is equal to, I will cover this concept, you know, when I go for different cross sections here. But as this particular shear stress equation is applicable only for circular cross sections, I have given you this polar moment of inertia, which is J is equal to pi d power 4 by 32, which is a constant for a circular cross section. But I is not like that, you know. I can, you know, the bending stress can be applied to any cross section. It may be circular, it may be rectangular, it may be square. So we will be seeing the value of I, you know, in the coming lecture. Okay, now so you got to know the stresses that are acting, right? So you got to know the stresses. What are those stresses? Axial, bending, and shear. Now, when I say the value I, inertia, moment of inertia, it was area moment of inertia. Now, when I say inertia, it differs from the different cross sections. For example, if I take square, which is having B, and B gives me, it is B power 4 by 12. If I take a rectangular cross section, which is D and which is B, depth D and breadth B, it gives us BD cube by 12. If I go for a circular cross section of a diameter D and radius R, it gives me pi d power 4 by 64. So you must be aware that, you know, every time when he asks you a shaft, or else he asks you to find the diameter, indirectly he says that it is a circular cross section and I value must be pi d power 4 by 64. Okay, so then when I substitute this particular formula in sigma b, that is bending equation, which is m y by I, where y is equal to, what did I say, y is equal to distance from the neutral axis to the outer fibers, which is y is equal to d by 2, which is nothing but its radius, and I is equal to pi d power 4 by 64. Pi d power 4 by 64. Now this gives us m into d by 2 by pi d power 4 by 64. And when I solve it, simplify it, 32 m by pi d cube. And this is very, very important in the context of our syllabus.
This video is brought to you by Monster Shakes, co-sponsored by TechnoSpark.
So it will be sigma b is equal to 32 m by pi d cube, and this is for examination purpose, it's more important. So this is regarding the stresses. Okay, I have given a brief introduction regarding the forces and stresses. Now we go into the concept deep. Okay, we will be going into deep concept. Actually, I forgot to say those shear stress equation, that is torsional equation, which is T by J is equal to tau by R is equal to G theta by L. Now what is tau? Tau is equal to TR by J, where J is equal to pi d power 4 by 32. Okay. Now R is equal to D by 2. Now what will be tau value? T into D by 2 by pi d power 4 by 32, which on simplifying gives me 16 T by pi d cube. Tau is equal to 16 T by pi d cube, and sigma B is equal to 32 M by pi d cube. So you have to be more, you know, precise with these equations, or else I suggest you to not to mug up these formulas, but you know, try to get these formulas by doing it from scratch. Okay, when you are going for any competitive exam like GATE, you know, when you come to know that it is directly a circular cross section, then it's you are happy to use these two formulas. Okay, when you practice these particular problems based on these formulas, you can able to memorize these particular, you know, formulas. Okay, particular formulas. So yeah, I'll be going. Now when you come to CO1 in DME, CO1, it's a very important for GATE also. So CO1 in mostly from CO1 itself, you can get around 4 to 6 marks. That is, you know, you might get 3 2 marks, or else, you know, 2 1 marks and 2 4 marks, sorry, 2 2 marks. So which will be accounting you to 6 marks. So CO1 we are having, as now we have gone through forces, right? So these forces, it depends upon the number of forces that are acting on a particular machine element. For example, if only one type of force is acting, we call it as uniaxial. We call it as uniaxial force. This is an example for a bar. If I take an example for a beam, it will look like this. These two examples for uniaxial These two are examples for uniaxial loading. When I go for multiaxial loading, that means, listen the term carefully, multiaxial, that means you will be applying load from different axes. So now when I apply load, so if we consider this as x-axis for this particular beam, when I apply a tensional load from here, now I can say that this particular, you know, case belongs to multiaxial loading. That means I am applying load in x direction and I am applying load in y direction, which is in axial direction and which is in transverse direction. So this particular, you know, case relates to multiaxial loading. So you know, when you are going for a uniaxial loading, so in a uniaxial loading, for example, if you go for a universal testing machine, so what happens in universal testing machine? So now when you go for uniaxial loading, that is a tensile bar, so you are much aware that it yields at a particular point due to shear, increase in shear, or else, you know, it reaches to yield strength, okay, it reaches to sigma y, yield strength, but it's a single axial loading, right? You know, all those 5 or 6 parameters which are responsible for the material to yield or else to fail will occur simultaneously. As I told you, if you take shear stress, that is yield shear, if you take, you know, yield in tensile, yield in shear and yield in tensile will occur simultaneously in uniaxial loading. But when it comes to multiaxial loading, you can't guarantee that yield in tensile and yield in shear occur simultaneously. So you know, why does this happens? Because in multiaxial loading, you will be having a, you know, the equivalence of these stresses which will be acting on principal planes, and we call it as principal stresses. So in principal planes we have two types of stresses, that is maximum principal stress, and which is represented with sigma 1, maximum okay. principal stress, and sigma 2, which is minimum principal stress. So when you are having stress in a multi-axial direction, you will be finding it by using sigma 1 and sigma 2. Now what are the formulas for sigma 1 and sigma 2 when you take a case from multi-axial loading? Now what is sigma 1? Sigma 1 is nothing but stress in x direction plus stress, that is summation of stresses in x direction and stress in y direction plus square root of sigma x minus sigma y by 2 whole square plus tau xy square. Okay, so now this is for maximum principal stress, and for minimum principal stress it will sigma x plus sigma y by 2 minus square root of sigma x minus sigma y by 2 whole square plus tau xy square. Now you will be having a doubt regarding what is stress acting in x direction, what is stress acting in y direction. Now if you consider an axial stress, you can say directly that stress is acting in x direction, that is when you take a axial loading, it acts in x direction, that is in its axis. Now when you take an transverse loading, for example, if I take a beam like this and I apply a load in this direction, now in which direction the stress will act? Due to this particular loading, the beam will be deflected like this, right? So when I take a point from here and I enlarge it, now the stress will be acting in this direction, which will be also in x direction. That is, the stress due to bending load, that is a transverse load, will also be in x direction. That is, stress due to bending load will also be in x direction. Now it tells us that in x direction, if I go for multi-axial loading, that is a force in axial direction and a force in transverse direction, I will be having two stresses in x direction, that is stress due to axial force and stress due to transverse force, which is sigma a plus sigma b. Now what will be the stress in y direction? It is null, that is it's zero. Sigma y is zero. Okay, sigma y is zero. And what will be its shear? Shear is also zero, as I haven't applied any torsion here. Okay, we will be taking that in the next case. Okay, so now that sigma x is equal to sigma a plus sigma b. Now just substitute here, it will be sigma y is equal to 0, sigma y is equal to 0, and tau xy is equal to 0 here also. Now we have to find the principal stress and maximum shear stress. And maximum shear stress, tau max, is equal to, you can find it directly from sigma 1 minus sigma 2 by 2, or else you can find it from Mohr circle. The radius of the Mohr circle gives you tau max, which is equal to square root of sigma x minus sigma y by 2 whole square plus tau xy square. Okay, sigma x minus sigma y whole square plus tau xy square. Now by using these particular formulas, we will be finding sigma 1, sigma 2 and tau max from this information. Now what happens after finding these? You will be able to find the resultant effect of these particular forces that are acting in different axial directions. Now you have to correlate this with the material properties. This is the biggest problem that you will face in multi-axial loading, because in uni-axial loading you can directly correlate these parameters, that is stress parameters, with yield stress, or else shear stress with yield shear. Okay, you can directly correlate, but in multi-axial loading you can't correlate it directly. So for that purpose we got a concept called theory of failures. So we got a concept, theories of failures, which explains us how to correlate these particular principal stresses that are developed from this multi-axial loading to the material properties and gives us a clear idea how do these particular materials subjected to this multi-axial loading fails, whether it may be a brittle failure, that is a fracture, or else whether it may be a ductile failure, which is considered as a change in shape, that is yielding. Okay, so we'll be going through theories of failures one by one, and we will be deciding which theory of failure will be good for which type of material. Okay, so this is regarding the basic concepts. Now, yeah, we will be going to theories of failures. Theories of failures. As I said that in multi-axial loading, you have to know the correlation.
This video is brought to you by Monster Shakes. Co-sponsored by TechnoSpark.
Between the, you know, those principal stresses and maximum shear stress to the maximum bearing load. So if I say it's brittle material, it should be an ultimate stress. If I say it's a ductile material, it should be yield stress as a criteria for design. Now if we go through theories of failures, the first theory of failure is maximum principal stress theory. Okay, and if you go, the second is maximum shear stress theory, and the third one is maximum strain energy, maximum principal strain theory. I'm sorry, maximum principal strain theory, and fourth one is total strain energy theory, and the last one is the most important one for design engineers, which is distortion energy theory, or most famously we call it as Von Mises theory. Von Mises Henke theory also, it is called as Von Mises and Henke, both of them has proposed this theory. Now when you go through maximum principal stress theory, the name itself tells us that it deals with maximum principal stress. In our nomenclature, what is maximum principal stress? That is sigma 1. So what is sigma 1? As I told you, these principles, these theories of failures will give a relation between the principal stresses and the material properties. When I say material properties, it can be sigma yt by factor of safety. Now what is sigma yt? Yield in tension, or else this is for ductile. Now when you go for brittle, it can be sigma ut by factor of safety, which is for brittle. Okay, now as per, you know, these experimental investigations suggest that mathematically also this particular principle, this particular theory of failure is more suitable for brittle materials. Now when you go for the second theory of failure, that is shear stress, maximum shear stress. Now tau max is equal to, as I told you, the maximum shear stress will also be equated to the material property. Now what is the material property? As I told you, maximum principal stress is equated to yield stress in tensile. Now this, in the same way, maximum shear stress is equated to yield in shear. That is, I would say S tau S Y, or else tau Y S. You can take like this, tau Y S by factor of safety. Now what does tau Y S represent? Tau Y S, which is yield in shear, and this is represented in some textbooks as SYS, and this is sigma yt, which is yield in tension, and this is represented as SYT in some textbooks. Now there should be some relation between yield in shear to yield in tension, which is nothing but 0.5 times of sigma yt by factor of safety. That means tau ys is equal to 0.5 times of sigma yt. Okay, 0.5 times of sigma yt. That is maximum shear stress theory. I'll be erasing this so that you can go for. So these concepts are very important for gate also. Now when you go for maximum principal strain theory, you know, these two theories are not considered as that much important, because you know these two theories are over conservative when compared to these particular three theories, that is maximum principal shear and distortion energy theory. Now when it takes maximum principal strain theory, you know strain, right? Strain can be represented like this. Epsilon is equal to sigma x by e minus mu into sigma y by e. That is, strain in x direction is equal to stress in x direction by Young's modulus minus Poisson's ratio into stress in y direction by Young's modulus. So if I say it's principal strain, it must be sigma 1, which is equal to sigma 1 by e minus mu into sigma 2 by e, which is equal to, now what is relationship between strain and stress in terms of material properties? So it will be sigma yt by e into, if I take factor of safety consideration, it will be sigma yt by e into factor of safety. Now if you see in this equation, Young's modulus is common, so when I cancel out this Young's modulus, my equation will be sigma 1 minus.
For more updates, stay tuned to KL Radio, the voice of KLians. This video is brought to you by Monster Shakes, co-sponsored by TechnoSpark.